Do-it-yourself groupies. Today we're going to be changing the rear brake pads on a 2007 Ford Econoline van, 4.6 liter V8. Whenever you go to the store, you're going to change your brakes. Make sure you get the right part for the job. Do it right the first time. And if you go to CarQuest, you can take your VIN number and they can match it up, even if you're not sure what your vehicle takes. Now I've already got the tire off. What you're going to need is a 7/8 impact socket. Go ahead and get that tire off. And then you've got all these studs here. You pull your tire off. Got your jack underneath here. Make sure you got a jack stand securing everything the way it's supposed to be. If you need a jack, there is a tool review for this Craftsman 3-ton jack in the description box below, along with other tools I'm using for this job. I try to do different tool reviews on this channel just to kind of give everybody a good idea on the average tools out here on the market that the do-it-yourselfer might use. That's why I like buying those tools and putting them to the test in real-world scenarios, from automotive repairs to industrial repairs and everything in between. Now today, some of the things you'll see used that I have reviewed on this channel is this Lyle brake spreader. Then I've got these HyperTough wrenches, good for banging. They're what I call banger wrenches. If you need to put them on a fastener and tap on them with a little hammer, then you know what? They're going to do the job that you need them to do, and you're not going to damage your better known name brand tools. We've got our 3/8 drive Pittsburgh Roto ratchet we might try out here. We got gear wrench. We've got Craftsman breaker bars. We got my 3/4 inch gear wrench here, along with the step down 3/4 to 1/2 inch reducer and impact socket by gear wrench, along with a few other things in between. Titan pry bars. If you need a pry bar set, go check out HyperTough down there at Walmart. They got a good set made in the USA. We're also going to use some brake parts cleaner from CarQuest, WD-40, high temperature disc brake grease. This is the Wherever Gold Premium brake pads with a limited lifetime warranty on them. This is part number GNAD-802. If you can see right there, they are ceramic. And then the rotor we picked up today is also Wherever. And there's the part number YH145251. Check the link in the description box below, because I'll post where you can buy these specific parts at. And no, I'm not paid for any of this stuff. I'm not endorsed by anybody. This is just where I shop at, who I trust, and some different things you can use to get the job done. Now the fastener sizes you're going to be working with today is 18 millimeter and 13 millimeter. The slide bolts on the caliper is going to be the 13 millimeter, and then the 18, you're going to have two different fasteners that you're going to have to take off that holds the bracket which holds the caliper on. If you're only changing your actual brake pads and you're not changing the rotor, then you can get by with only using the 13 millimeter, and that should be about all you need, along with a pry bar or a screwdriver, something of that nature, and of course the bleeder wrench, usually 3/8 drive. Now the first thing you're going to start with, and I've already loosened these up, but I'll go ahead and show you here. This is your brake caliper, and this is your bracket, okay? Right here, you're going to have this 13 millimeter slide pin bolt up top, and then you're going to have another one right here on the bottom. Both of those are going to be 13. This right here is going to be your bleeder. So whenever you go to change your brakes, the only thing you're going to have to take off here is going to be those two 13 millimeter bolts. Now what you can do to do that, usually they're not very, very tight, and if they are, you can always get yourself a nice little breaker bar set. Get yourself a 6-point socket, put on there, break it loose if you have to. Always remember righty tighty, lefty loosey. But if you need to, you can also use a wrench. Now with the wrench, all you have to do is put this on here, hold it in place, take yourself a hammer and tap on it gently, and it'll also break it loose. But if it's pretty good and it's not really nice and tight, then you can get by with using something as simple as this. It's nice, cheap, inexpensive, makes your life so much easier. Or use one of a mechanic's favorite tools right here, and that being a flex head ratcheting wrench. Now this set I have is Cobalt, but I do have a lot of gear wrench tool reviews in the description box below you can check out. I've had these Cobalts for years. This is the Taiwan version of these. I don't think they sell them anymore, but these have been a pretty good set for the price. the great thing about the gear wrench or the ratcheting wrench is you can easily flex the head and get in behind things around obstructions, and it makes your job a lot easier. Now here's another problem. Pulled these bolts out right here. These are supposed to have grease on them. Alright, these are your slide pin bolts. They go in and out, back and forth. As you compress your brake, the caliper pushes out. This pin here is supposed to move back and forth with ease. Now, this one does. Whether the bottom one does or not, we're uncertain yet. But this, with no grease in it, what can happen here is moisture gets in there, you know, salt, rust, contamination, and then it will eventually expand and it will seize up. And when these things seize up, your caliper's basically ruined. You'll end up having to knock it out, take a torch to it. I've had to take torches to several different calibers before, even had to drill one or two to get them out. And most of the time, the best option is replacing the entire caliber. But not a lot of people can afford to do that. So make sure you grease these every time you change your brakes. Now, in order to break these loose, all you need is a screwdriver, which, you know, everybody uses, or you can get yourself a simple pry bar like this. Like I said, they got a good set at Walmart on sale. This is the Titan version, and then just kind of pry this caliper back and forth until it comes loose. Do not let it hit the ground because it will mess your hose up. Gently pick it up and lay it somewhere where it takes the tension off of the actual hose. If that hose gets bound up, gets kinked, it could create damage, and then your brakes are going to end up seizing up because the caliper most of the time will try to push that brake fluid back and it won't go nowhere, and it will keep your caliper extended and you'll have brakes consecutively. Now once that is out of the way, all you have to do, once again, get yourself something to pry on, a little pry bar, get yourself a screwdriver or something, and stick in here and just start moving your pads. And these are very loose and they are very, very worn out. Now this side does have pad. Always separate. If you're not sure which side goes to what, just pull them out here and lay them the direction you got them off in. Now, as you can see, this was metal to metal. That's why I went ahead and got the rotor that the customer wanted. The other problem is sometimes whenever brakes are this bad, you know, you're going to have a rotor. And sometimes the emergency brake, the parking brake on the inside is bad also. If that's the case, then, you know, we're going to have a separate video. You can check out the channel for that. But you separate those. Now, if you have to take the rotor off, which we're going to do, you're going to have to take this fastener loose right here and take the fastener loose right there. You're going to pull this guard off here, and then you're going to have to take the other fasteners loose right there. And those are not just a fastener. They're actually attached to the bolt, so whenever you're pulling it out, the whole piece should come out with it, which unloosens this mounting bracket right here. If you're only changing your brakes, then you basically eliminate that entire step right there. But if you are changing your rotor, you have to do it. A lot of the time, those fasteners also have Loctite on them, you know. Anti-seize is something that you'll put on your bolts and stuff when you don't want something to seize up. But Loctite's what they use usually from the factory. It's usually yellow, red, green, something of that nature. And it keeps the threads locked up nice and tight inside there. Prevents them from coming loose over time. Depending on how much the factory put on, depends on how much of a time you're going to have when you get to that. Now the outside one shouldn't be too bad. You can try it out by putting your open end on here. Like I said, you can get a 6-point on here. 6 points better than 12 because it reduces the amount you'll round off the fastener. But if you have to put a 12-point, just put it on here and then tap on it with the hammer. So considering the outside here is broke loose, I'm gonna go ahead and put my gear wrench on here, and this just makes the job so much easier. How about that? That might have been stuck on there a little bit because it's actually turning the inside fastener there. Wow, that's bringing them both out. That works too, but same concept here. You loosen up the top one, you loosen up the bottom one, and once you pull these outer fasteners out, you pull this bracket off here, and then you get these inside fasteners out. Now, of course, if this locks up on you, that's when you're going to need two different wrenches. That way you can hold one and then turn the other one off. Now, once the outer ones are off, go ahead and pull that little guard off here and just make sure you know which direction it's facing. Set it off here to the side. And then get your other fasteners off. As you can see right there, it loosens up the bracket. And right here is what I was talking about. We have yellow Loctite. And then once your brackets off. Make sure it stays in the same direction too. Now you're ready to pull off your rotor. Now these rotors are designed, your parking brake is on the inside of these rotors, and they're shaped just like a set of shoes. So you gotta pull it, wiggle it, top, bottom, left, right, back and forth, and it will come loose here, off. Right, there we go. As you can see, this is your parking brake / emergency brake, and that is also a problem too. The pad is completely gone. That could be what this customer heard rubbing and grinding up. He said it was grinding horribly, horribly as he was driving it. And we know that the brakes are bad. You know, the shoes are all mangled up and stuff, but that could have led to that problem. And I'm gonna have to get off here for a second and call the shop. Okay, unfortunately, I have called the shop, and I prefer, like I said, dealing with CarQuest, and they'll have me the parking brakes and all the gear with it in the morning. By that, I mean all the rest of the springs and, you know, the assembly and stuff that goes with it. So, essentially, the customer's going to need his van back so that he can take it to work, do his job tomorrow. So, he already knows what's going on. He said he's got to pay for it, then he just does. So we're going to go ahead and change his brakes and his rotor, and then he's going to bring this thing back and we will do just the parking brake by itself, and I'll make a separate video of it, so check out the channel for that. But here is what the rotor looks like, as you can see. Now sometimes you can turn these, and this one might be able to be turned. It's one of those things. I will take it up to CarQuest and see, and if they can turn it, I'll just go ahead and pay for them to turn it. And, you know, if the customer wants to, they will take the brand new rotor back. And then he can get, you know, credited. I won't charge him for that if he gets credited for it. But we'll just see where it goes. Either way, with the new and the old, you want to make sure that they are identical. Set them side by side. Make sure you got the same lug pattern on each one and all that good stuff in between. Stick them on top of each other if you need to. With that being said, I did go ahead and talk to the customer. He said he'll just go ahead and pay for it, take the hit. I'll go ahead and turn this thing anyhow, and if it can be turned, I'll keep it for a spare. Might be able to hook somebody else up in the future because I work on a lot of these. And we'll just go ahead and put his brand new rotor here on. Okay, on the passenger side here, what I am going to do is I'm going to go ahead and run this down. That way, it brings these actual brake pads away from the rotor until we can get this thing changed. Now if you're on the passenger side, going in the upward motion is what's going to adjust them downward, which will take them away from the rotor if you have to get into a situation and do this, which is going to allow for plenty of clearance right here for me to stick this rotor on, and we won't have to worry about this popping out and rubbing into it. You're going to go ahead and get your rotor on, line it up, and push it straight on here. Make it all the way back real good. Make sure that those brakes are not touching on the inside, because you can always adjust them out afterwards by going through the back sides, pulling this little plug out and doing it that way. Now we'll reassemble. When you start putting your bracket back on, it goes on the inside of the frame here, right next to the rotor, and then you start your bolt down here and then your bolt up here. Next is your bracket, your shield. You put those on and then tighten up those two fasteners. Make sure everything's tightened and torqued down good. Now match up your old and your new brake shoes to make sure, or brake pads, sorry. Make sure they're all good. Go ahead and install your new pieces here. They essentially go right there and right here, your hardware does. Now to help the brakes slide on, I'll take some of this brake grease and I'll just dab it right here just a little bit. And I'll dab it right here just a little bit. Take these forks here and then you slide one of them on and push it inside here like so. Push down on it, get it in place, and then slide the other one on. Once you slid it in place, make sure your hardware is still in place and it's up in there flush. Then do the same to the other side. You slide it in there, make sure it's nice and straight, and it should slide right on that way. Now take this little rubber booty off. Find your grease plug. And this one is a 3/8 wrench. Now you want to make sure you do not strip this out. So if you can, put a 6-point on it. Go get you a 6-point wrench specifically for this if you can. If not, put something on here. Lightly tap it if it is stuck until you see just a little bit of brake fluid coming out. And then you're ready to push those calipers back. Now generally you can take your brake spreader, your C-clamp, whatever it is, put you a brake shoe in here, and then push those things back after you open up the bleeder plug. You gotta open it up while you're depressing those pistons. That way they go back nice and easy. However, I have opened it up, loosened it up, and I'm going to be putting this hose on it. So whenever I'm putting the brake spreader on there, it is going to put all the fluid right here instead of on the ground. Then I'll pull it off and I'll shut the plug off. If you wanna see how to bleed your brakes, well, stay tuned, because there will be a video uploaded soon here to the Backwoods Mechanic channel. And if you want to see how to use these, go check out the tool review. Now if you want to learn how to use this particular brake spreader by Lyle, just check out the link in the description box below. You're going to crack that bleeder plug open. You got this thing in here. You're going to squeeze this nice and tight. It's going to push those pistons back, and then you tighten up that bleeder screw and then reassemble your caliper. Now sometimes that Lyle brake spreader does not work. It bends it all to hell before it works, unfortunately. The one thing that will work, unless your caliber seized up, is a big old C-clamp, your old pad right here. Then all you gotta do is twist it a little at a time, crack open this bleeder, tighten it back up just as soon as you get it in. Go back and forth with it until you get this thing flush inside your caliber. Those pistons need to be flush inside here, then you can get ready to mount it back up. Now after those are pushed in, as you can see right there, pistons pushed in, you want to make sure that these slides are lubed up, that they're sliding back and forth. Now this one's a little bit rough down here, it's not wanting to move that much. So we're going to loosen it up, and then we're going to put some grease in behind them little booties. As you can see, them little booties do pop back, grease this side first, then the back side here. If you have a greasing needle, you know, basically a grease gun, you put the grease needle on there, shoot it back in behind there, it works real great. You can spray it down with WD-40 deep grease, but grease works the best. Now once these are all nice and greased up, the next thing you want to make sure is greased is these. These are very, very important to grease. That is your slide pins that go into that caliber right there that we just showed you. That way when that caliber moves in and out, it slides on these right here. If they seize up, you're in for a world of hurt. Now generally, whenever you slide it in, I usually start with the top one on these because it's much easier. You push those little sliders out, and then you get your bolt in there, and whenever you're guiding it in, guide it up and under your hardware right here. Once it clips in right there, you're right close to that hole where you need to put that in to start the threads. Push it in here at the bottom. You should be able to start the threads up top. It'll hold it just enough. Make sure you grease. As you can see, it's greased up good. Get your other one greased. Get it started. Tighten it up. And I do want to clarify real quick what I meant by that, because there is hooks right here. You set the bottom half of the caliber in here first, right behind where that hardware is. Them little hooks keep it in place. You put the top half in and then start your bolt first, is what I was basically trying to say there. That way somebody don't, you know, put it in top first and then the bottom and, you know, get all confused and stuff. That's what I was meaning by that. Then of course, once all's good, tighten everything up. Make sure your cap's back on your bleeder here. Make sure your bleeder is nice and tight. Of course, when this is all said and done, I'm going to do a brake bleed on this system. So you all can check out that video separately. I know this one's run kind of long. But otherwise, everything else went fairly decent with this. Now, there's a lot of complications that could happen. It just takes a lot to talk through those complications. And this video is long enough as it is. Altogether, if everything goes good, you have no problems like worn out rotors or, you know, brake shoes or this, that, and the other, whatever it is that you're doing. If you're doing one specific job, you know, other things might happen along the way that might complicate that job. But if everything's all right and you keep your vehicles maintained properly, you change everything when you were supposed to per the owner's manual, you know, you should be in good shape. Just do the job right. Now all that's left to do is for me to put this tire and everything back on, slap the lug nuts on it, pump the brakes up, do my brake bleed. But until next time, if you want to check out some more do-it-yourself how-to videos, I bounce around and do different stuff. I work doing industrial repairs. I also do mobile repairs, such as what I'm doing here today. I go out and contract my services to different companies with their fleet vehicles, with their equipment. So you might see a wide variety of stuff on this channel. But hopefully this helps someone out. If it did, check out the tool reviews, check out the links, leave a comment down below, and make repairs great again.